So how did you decide when to start introducing all the characters?
You mean like the various villains and characters that would come up? But, I mean, really, it was kind of an instinct thing, you know? A lot of it is like when we map out the season in the writer's room and we're looking at it all, we have people kind of like, you want people to kind of like, their storylines to climax and then like have a denouement. And like, so we're saying, okay, Penguin's had a really huge story for this period and he's going to be, you know, kind of like resting for a while. So then it's like a great 2-episode arc to bring in Scarecrow for those times. So we, you know, it's like you know, these, all these intersecting like sine curves and cosine curves that are going through. That's math through the season. So it was really just kind of like trying to balance everything. And you know, you kind of get those feelings too, where we'll tell like a real like a Falcone Maroni story for like 2 episodes, which can feel very like mobby. So then you're saying, oh, well, now I really want like a story that's going to feel more super villainy. So we'll do like Jonathan Strange or a Red Hood episode, something like that. So it really is like a feel, just like a
feel. Can you give us a sense?
That's pretty specific, huh?
Can you give us a sense of the direction going into kind of as we started heading towards the finale, like an overview of where we're going?
Sure. There's like going to be a 3-episode arc that's going to begin in 19 that goes to like 20, 21. Yeah, that's 3. Which is Gordon's investigating the serial killer that's going to impact him in his really personal way. That's going to have like repercussions all through season 2. Like really damaging. The Penguin story that he's been running up against like his kind of like rise. This season we kind of thought of as the rise of the Penguin. But the Penguin story will come to like a really bloody and dark conclusion in the finale as we see like all of his plans and machinations finally kind of like erupt and like kind of start to rip Gotham apart. And we see Gordon's kind of like butting heads with the establishment inside the GCPD as well, kind of like coming apart. And then you see other characters who are coming forward and like really doing things, and we see sides of them as they take like those evolutionary steps forward to becoming the people they're going to become. Selina, Enigma, Bruce, all of those characters take those big jumps forward, going, oh, I see you actually are on the path to becoming the person you're going to be, that we all know you're going to be. So.
It's going to be hard to pace out knowing how young our Bruce Wayne is in this show and how much fun it will be to get to these villains when they're their full-fledged selves.
Right.
How do you guys handle that in the red room, the instinct to want to go to the most fun place, but know that you've got to like draw it out and draw it out a little bit?
You know, it's... I mean, I think a lot of times... I don't know, it's the telling the origin stories, we've taken a lot of like steps even further back, you know? Like even telling like a Jonathan Crane origin story, we actually focused on the father, not on Crane himself, you know? And we tried to take a lot of like lateral steps for those things too. Like everybody knows the Red Hood story that we can read like in the Alan Moore story. So we just took like a different Red Hood story that we tried to say, okay, let's take all of these and go even further back in time and try to tell an interesting story. I don't know. I mean, honestly, it's one of those things where we always kind of go, we know we can't go there. So what's the most interesting version that we can tell here that will make the journey there? Like, it's as if we all know we're driving to Chicago. But on the way to Chicago, you're like, hey, let's stop in Reno. This is actually going to be a lot of fun. Oh, my God. We got shot in Reno. Whatever.
So many of the characters you have to keep because we know they have a future.
Right.
But Jada announced that she wasn't coming back as Fish. So is there a potential for her to come back, or are you happy that you actually have a character you can come back?
I mean, I think, I don't know if she's going to come back or not. You know, I mean, I feel like you guys have to watch the finale and see what happens. And then I also live in a world in which, you know, characters can come back frequently, you know. And also, DC has been really flexible about characters who we in the canon know, oh, they survive because they have to do X later. Those characters, as we'll see going forward, even in this season, they are not invulnerable. Some of those characters who everyone will expect to survive will not survive. And which I think will make things like exciting, because when you actually see that other characters have a target on their back, that you know that nobody's safe, and then you can watch that name or whatever gets reinvented later on in another fashion. So.
Are there any like major locations from like Batman lore, like the Batcave, that we might be seeing in the near future?
Possibly. Yes, there are some major locations in the lore that we'll see in this season, that you'll watch in the season. Again, I'm not really going to say more than that, but you will see them in the next couple of episodes. Where again, it's going to be part of those, like when I was talking about those big character steps forward, we'll see them becoming those people.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, one of the things you guys had, in addition to extra episodes added this season, you also got the very, very early season 2 renewal. Can you just talk about how that kind of changed your writing process for this season and what that might mean for what that will mean for season 2?
Sure. We originally thought we were doing 16 episodes. So we had arced out the season to end at 16 episodes, so we had to kind of like start building things out again. Like, we actually weren't going to do Jonathan Crane this year. When we got those extra six episodes, we did that. We built in the Fish getting kidnapped by the Dollmaker storyline that had not existed before, you know. We weren't going to do a Red Hood story. We had not planned on doing Flying Graysons, you know. So we brought in some of the characters that we were actually planning on saving for later, frankly. But this next year, ways that, like, the early pickup has affected our storytelling now is like we're arcing the whole 22 season. Less than now. So we actually know where we're going, where we're ending up, and so hopefully it'll feel a little less panicked.
And you're bringing Lucius Fox?
We are bringing in Lucius Fox.
Can you talk about what we're going to see?
He's played by Chris Chalk, who's a great actor. And just also a fan of the material, too, which is always great to have on the show. And he has a small appearance this year, but he's going to play a much larger role next season. So as we've seen, like, Bruce, like, young Bruce, like, investigating what's going on in his family's company, that mystery will kind of, like, deepen next year, and Lucius starts to play a role. Bruce doesn't know who he is yet, you know, and doesn't know what his intentions really are, as they kind of, like, find their way towards a relationship next year, and he helps them, like, uncover the mystery. So,
what can you say about Fish's trajectory in the last few episodes? Because obviously she is further apart, set apart from kind of everything that's going on.
She does, I mean, we will see her with all the other characters by the end of the season, and obviously Penguin's final, like, rise couldn't happen without Fish being a part of it, you know, so we'll see the two of them kind of come back together and, like, yeah, you know, really, hopefully, satisfying.